As part of the activities during my last visit to Ghana, I took a trip to Cape Coast in the central region. I entered the township through the beach road and I loved the view. P.S. If you are driving around, some roads within the city are one way only. After asking around for a while, we made it to my destination, the Cape Coast Castle. Cape Coast Castle is one of about 40 slave castles and forts built on the coast of Ghana by European traders in 1555.
Good morning, sir.
Hi, good morning. Good morning.
It was such an honor to be welcomed by Mr. Isao Blankson, who is the Western Regional Director at the Ghana Museums and Monuments Board.
Nice. What do you have in store for me today?
A lot about our history, culture, as a people, as a continent, and many things.
I'm excited.
Yes.
Let's do it.
Once you go through the entrance, there is the National Coat of Arms embossed on the wall.
Now, let me tell you about this, our national emblem.
Yes.
He took his time to break down its meanings.
Divided into four by a cross. Mm-hmm. Right. These two were the symbols of the Crusaders, the early Portuguese Crusaders who arrived here as explorers. At the top right corner of it, see the white spot?
Yes.
It's an edifice of a castle. That's very nice. And it shows the role these buildings have played in our socio-economic and political development as a people. Opposite that is a cross of a traditional sword and staff. That shows the role our traditional authorities play in a modern political dispensation. Below it is a tree.
Mm-hmm.
That represents the vegetation and the rich resources we have in the forest. Opposite that is a mining shaft that represents the minerals, in oil, in gold, in diamonds, and many underneath the surface resources. And flanking the shields are two eagles. These represent our leaders who have to get a foresight and the strength to protect our resources.
He escorted and educated me as we combed through the castle. This was my first visit to the castle, so I was extra attentive to all that he said as we walked into the courtyard.
We are here, sir.
Yes, we are here. Yes, yes. And this is where you're here.
Okay.
Your car is parked right here.
Okay.
But after the slave trade was abolished, the castle served as a point where certain European ideas and cultural practices were introduced. And foremost of this was Christianity, then some formal education. State institutions developed from here. And so in the nutshell, this facility has served in diverse ways.
Mentioned Christianity. Yes. Does it mean that we didn't know Christianity before their arrival or before their
Christianity
presence?
Christianity is an European religion. Although Africans in some part of Africa have experienced some form of Christianity, you know, in the Egypt and Ethiopia, in the Sudan, that was where the first Coptic church developed after the persecution, during the persecution of Jesus Christ, some disciples moved to Ethiopia and Egypt to establish the Coptic Church. But the kind of Christianity we have today was introduced by the Europeans.
Next, we made our way into the male slave dungeon. As you can see, I went prepared with a lantern because I heard it was dark in there.
We will go through it and experience how the captives survived the dungeon. So you see, there were no lights.
No.
So the hole up there provided them with light.
Wow.
And ventilation. And they stayed here for about 3 months.
That small hole?
Yes. They stayed here for about 3 months on the average. And whilst they were here, they urinated, they defecated, they vomited, they ate, and they slept here. Occasionally, they were let out to be fed and also to crack stones with cannonballs that were used in building the dungeons. Soldiers advised them.
Okay.
Yeah, sometimes when the captives were in angry mood, food was thrown in from there.
Oh, wow, that's another hole.
Yes. That was used by some of the domestic captives. Those who were sick and weak and not strong enough to survive in the dungeons were used as servants. Some of them were made to hide in there to listen to the conversations in the dungeon, to know if there were plots of escapes, if there were plots of rebellions or revolts. And all those who were implicated were held separately in the dungeon to the right.
The The dungeons have this peculiar smell that I can't explain. Maybe it's the decaying building materials. The smell wasn't a good one, but it wasn't a stench though.
They were not here in chains. Tunnel on the floor served as a drainage for their feces and urine. And when it rains, most often depending on the direction of the wind, water came in through these holes. And as you can see, the water marks on the wall.
Yes.
This came to wash out the urine and feces from the dungeon.
Whilst they are here.
Whilst they were here. So the whole place got covered with filth. And many of them got sick and died here.
Yes.
The floor on which we are walking now has been excavated.
We then visited the shrine at the far end of the male slave dungeon. A fetish priest welcomed us.
Therefore, in our traditional societies, and I believe in most societies, one cannot approach an important person directly. Go through a linguist, secretaries, or protocols, as they are generally known. And so these gods served as linguists, protocols, or secretaries between man and God.
It is said that he is the mediator between the people and the spirit god, called Nanatabil. The priest performed libation and prayed to the gods for us.
So this part of the dungeon was also used as a sorting room. And so when they were ready to leave, they were sorted out to know which belongs to who. And behind this wall, there was a tunnel through which the captives were led to the exit. When we go out, we look through the tunnel and also go through the exit. But when the trade was abolished, the authorities realized there were some merchants and officials who were secretly shipping captives through the dungeons. So the tunnel was sealed to stop that illegal trading activities here.
Is he always there?
No, sir.
We made our way back into the light and on top of the slave dungeon.
The light on top of the dungeon was a church. The official English church. Sponsored a group of missionaries here, called the Society for the Propagation of the Gospel.
The missionaries knew what was going on down
here.
Yes. And it was okay.
Come. This was an entrance, a secret entrance into the dungeon. So while the psalms and songs were coming from here, the groans and moans were also coming from here.
Mr. Blankson told me about the birth of the famous Amazing Grace song that we all sing and know of.
Have you heard of the song Amazing Grace? You know who composed it? It's called John Newton.
John, yes.
John Newton. John Newton was a slave merchant.
Wow.
Yes. He traded severally along this coast and particularly in this very castle. And right on the ship, they have similar colors. In fact, these buildings or castles were also referred to as ships at permanent anchor. And so they were designed just like the ship. He listened to the sounds that came in. Most often, musicologists call them the West African sorrow chant. Now, John Newton puts the words to the sounds he heard
from the
basement of the ship as he traveled along there.
He was getting his inspiration from here.
From them. So if you go to the Library of Congress, it is recorded about the song. It says, words by John Newton, melody unknown.
Yes.
We then descended to the area where the cannons start facing the sea.
Oh, wow.
These are cannons, all used in a battle to defend the castle against pirates and other nationals who tried to capture it. Because the trade was very lucrative and it attracted all sorts of interests. And so some of the wars and misunderstandings in Europe were also settled here. If you have read of the Wars of Crusades, you have read of the Anglo-Dutch Wars, the Anglo-Franco Wars, Franco-Prussian Wars, and all those wars that were fought in Europe were also fought here. So if you have been to New York,
yes,
New York has a direct history with this facility.
Of course.
Yeah, they called it, they used to call it New Amsterdam.
New Amsterdam.
Yes, belonged to the Dutch, and this facility belonged to the Dutch.
To the Dutch.
At a point in time. And so
the English sent out a troop to capture both Amsterdam and Cape Coast simultaneously. Yes. And as you came from Accra, you probably saw a fort on a hill.
Fort Amsterdam?
Fort Amsterdam. That was the first English fort in West Africa.
We were literally walking on top of the old tunnel where the slaves walked last before departed on the ships.
That's what we are working on.
Okay.
Right. Part of it was a dungeon before. Before that dungeon we visited was constructed, the captives were kept here. This was an underground dungeon and it held as many as 500 captives. Again, if you are familiar with Bob Marley, song, all pirates, yes,
redemption song.
Yes.
Yes.
You know, in some parts it says, minutes after day to cry from the bottomless pit. That's what I lie on to remember. From the bottomless pit.
Oh, wow. Here, this is what he meant.
This is what he meant.
But my hands was made strong by the hands of the Almighty.
We forward in this generation.
Don't you have to say the song.
So that song is about our experience and our survival as a people.
Yeah.
Yes. So this was the tunnel. We are looking through the tunnel now. This was a supervisory post. So soldiers and supervisors stood here to supervise as the captives went through from the dungeon to the exit. Yes. Now this room served as warehouses for the incoming goods and outgoing ones. So the guns and gunpowders and many things that were brought in. Above it were the rooms for the merchants and the officials. So they called it the gentleman's room.
Okay.
And on top of that is what we call the palaver hall. That was where meetings were held, where war plans were drawn, peace agreements signed, and also where captives were auctioned. So when a captive arrived here for the first time, he was taken there and examined by a doctor to see how strong and healthy he was. So let's say a strong person like yourself, for instance, may go for about 8 guns, but 4 kegs of gunpowder, bottles of whiskey or schnapps, some second-hand clothes, tobacco, alcohol, and many items in a package. When the buyer smelled your upper right hand here with palm oil, it will be branded. Officials or the merchant, agent or company. So they have JSS, John Smith's name.
Sold.
For nothing. This was the end of the tunnel. See, as you can see, this part is also sealed.
Yes.
It was sealed in the space here used as a warehouse in addition to this. And that was when this door here was enlarged. Before, it had a small door that allowed one person out at a time. So when they stepped out, they were chained. They waited in line till they got a sizable group. And they marched them through that door. So that door became known as the door of no return. But just behind you was a cell. Go in. It was a cell for the female captives. So
wow.
We then visited the female dungeons.
So if you enter in, the gate will close behind you.
Okay.
You see the hinges on the sides. These dungeons held between 500 and 800 women and children. The average age was between 13 and 30.
Whoa.
They were as dark as the male one.
And one significant thing I want to point out to you is, you can see it was there.
It was a door.
Through this door, some of the soldiers and officials came in to select the women. They washed them and raped them and after brought them back. Now those women that were found to be pregnant in the dungeons were taken out. There were stone houses with hired mistresses whose business was to take care of such women. So after they delivered, they brought them back. The babies were left behind.
What happened to the babies?
Most of them died. The few of them that survived from the core of the castle schools established on the dungeons. Those who were found to be pregnant on the ships were thrown into the ocean.
those who were sick and considered weak, that they will not be able to make the journey. So they followed them. So there were sharks following the ships that were feeding on them. And when there was a food shortage on board the ships, the sharks were trapped to feed the captives on the ships.
Then the famous door of no return, which is now called the door of return.
Through this door, millions of Africans have been forced into slavery. As it stands now, it signifies the separation of the African family. The beginning of a journey and the end of an experience.
And I agree. This door signifies the end of freedom and the beginning of slavery. Once we were out of the door, he filled me in on how the slaves were loaded onto the waiting canoes and sent to the waiting ships.
From the wharf to this castle was a restricted area. Called it European Beach, Abrafum Pano. This was the official entrance to the castle.
He concluded this priceless tour by taking me into the warehouses and the condemned cell.
This was a cell for those who persistently tried to escape. Those who escaped and were rearrested, and those who were violent. They were held here without food, water, air, light.
I must confess, this was a fact-filled tour, and I pray you all visit the castle to learn more. Many thanks to Mr. Blankson for his epic enlightenment. Feel free to drop any comments or questions about this castle, and I promise to get the answers from Mr. Blankson for you. If you got this far, then thanks for staying with me. Do same for the next episode, which would be about travel and lifestyle.
Thanks for watching. Bye.